Hacks and data breaches are ever increasing. Over half of all companies in the United States have experienced data breaches in 2024. Maybe you've even gotten an email or a dozen about your own data being involved in one. The chance that happens grows every day. After all, there are only two types of companies, those that have been hacked and those that will be. It's one thing when it's caused by common thieves or carelessness, but what if it's a hostile foreign country behind the breach? This type of incident is also on the rise, primarily caused by Advanced Persistent Threats, or APTs. APTs are not your typical cybercriminals. These are disciplined groups, backed by the funding and skills of nation-states. They prioritize stealth and the long game, focusing less on financial gain and more on gathering intelligence, patents, classified documents, or even access to infrastructure, both physical and digital. APTs have been around longer than you might think. The first recorded case of hacking by a country was in 1986. KGB-supported hackers managed to gain remote access to the computers at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and stole documents relating to American nuclear weapons and Reagan's planned strategic defense initiative. Though far less organized than today's APTs, it marked the first case of nation-state hacking. APTs truly got their start in the 2000s, using the same tactics that have been effective even recently. One of the first modern APT attacks was conducted by the Chinese group Comet Panda in an attack known as Titan Rain. This happened in 2003, when unclassified networks at NASA, Lockheed Martin, and the US Department of Defense were breached. Nothing classified is believed to have been stolen, but it was an alarming incident nonetheless. Quick aside to talk about the naming conventions for APTs, basically every cybersecurity company uses a different naming scheme. I like CrowdStrike's because it's easy to remember and they have cool illustrations to go along with them. China's APTs are pandas, Russia's are bears, Iran's are kittens, North Korea's are cholimas, and America doesn't have an animal because I guess hacking isn't a crime when we do it. The next most common schemes are simply numbering them, used by the US government and many companies. Microsoft used to name APTs after elements or element-sounding names, but they've started to use names related to weather as of late. Often, APTs get names outside of these systems, and those become common. I'll stick as closely as I can to CrowdStrike's system and mention other common names. Russian APTs got the next big cyber attack, what the Department of Defense calls Buckshot Yankee. In 2008, a virus called Agent.BTZ made its way into the Pentagon's computers, probably via an infected USB drive. Various classified documents, as well as battle plans for use in Afghanistan and Iraq, were stolen, and cleanup of the virus took over 14 months. The incident was bad enough to prompt the Defense Department to create the Cyber Command branch. Two Russian APTs were behind the attacks, Fancy Bear and Cozy Bear, known as Grizzly Step when working together. They also go by the numbers APT-28 and APT-29, respectively. Not all APTs go after things that are of immediate intelligence value. Take the GhostNet operation in 2009. This one is believed to have been done by Lotus Panda, or APT-30. This attack was against Chinese dissidents abroad, particularly the Dalai Lama and the Tibetan government in exile. Investigators found the same types of hacks occurred in diplomatic missions of various countries around the world around the same time, particularly countries in the South China Sea region. The gathered information was mainly personal online data of people working in embassies and within dissident groups. GhostNet wasn't just some attack against far-off servers and governments, it had effects on normal, real people. There's an anecdotal account of a Tibetan woman in China who was arrested based off information taken from her Skype chat logs. She was held for 2 months and was presented with her Skype logs when she denied working for a Tibetan NGO. Lotus Panda got this information from good ol' social engineering, like many APTs. Lotus Panda sent highly targeted phishing emails with malware attached to gain access to various computers, and they've been doing this for over 2 decades, using basically the same malware the whole time, no less. It looks ancient. A majority of APTs, I don't think you can put an exact number on it, use phishing and spear phishing for a significant portion of their attacks. That's where the APT, or any other threat, sends disguised emails to get someone to download and run their malware. It really is true, amateurs hack systems, professionals hack people. Another Chinese APT was discovered using the same tactics a few years later in 2011, our friends Comet Panda again, or APT-1. Operation Shady Rat began around 2006, using well-crafted spear phishing attacks. Shady Rat was discovered by McAfee, who described it as the biggest transfer of wealth in terms of intellectual property in history. McAfee uncovered the attacks via a command and control server Comet Panda was using to remotely access and control victim computers. The attacks were against a huge range of targets, including the governments of Canada, India, South Korea, Taiwan, the United States, and Vietnam. At least 12 American defense contractors were hacked, though McAfee declined to name them. Multinational organizations were also hacked, including ASEAN, the UN, the IOC, and the World Anti-Doping Agency. These hacks were some of the longest running ever seen. They were often able to stay in an infiltrated network for over 2 years. One of the longest APT campaigns is also perhaps the most famous, Stuxnet. Stuxnet has been covered a ton, so I won't dwell on it too much here. It was a worm developed by a first Western APTs, the American NSA's Equation Group, and the Israeli Unit 8200. Development of Stuxnet began around 2005, when concerns about Iran's nuclear weapons program were growing. Israel was begging America to allow them to conduct airstrikes on Iranian nuclear facilities, but was turned down. Equation Group had access to exploits previously used by the NSA's Tailored Access Operations Division, and built off of those to create Stuxnet. They also looped in the Israelis to placate them, but their contribution was very minor. Known as the bug within the NSA, Stuxnet was made to hamper Iran's nuclear program by causing physical damage to their equipment. Due to nuclear facilities not being out on the internet, it had to be physically introduced to the target computer network via a USB drive. It would then spread very rapidly within the network. Stuxnet looked for programmable logic controllers, specialized devices for controlling industrial machines. In this case, it wanted centrifuges, machines for enriching uranium that could be used for building a nuclear weapon. Stuxnet would subtly alter the behavior of these centrifuges over time, while hiding this information from the operator. It would eventually completely destroy the centrifuge by closing various valves in the machine, leading to a fairly violent explosion. It isn't clear how much this affected Iran's nuclear program. Available data doesn't show any strong correlation with Stuxnet activity and enriched uranium production. I'll link the white paper from Symantec in the description if you're interested in reading more about it. North Korea came on the scene of government hacking a few years later, with two big attacks in 2013 and 2014. Both of these were done by the North's premier hacking group, Labyrinth Trollima, better known as the Lazarus Group, Whois Team, and also APT-38. In response to tightened sanctions against North Korea in 2013, they began a cyber attack against many organizations in the South. Finance and media companies were the hardest hit, but they didn't have their information pilfered like you might expect. This was straight-up destruction, using a wiper malware called Dark Soul. Come on, that's a great name. News channels went offline, and ATMs were down for a few days. A similar attack was repeated a few months later, where many South Korean government websites and news sites were defaced with pro-North messages. In total, the attack destroyed the information on approximately 50,000 computers and caused around $750 million in damages. A similar but more targeted attack was orchestrated by Labyrinth Trollima against Sony Pictures in 2014. This was in retaliation for the movie The Interview, involving a fictional plot to assassinate Kim Jong-un. Labyrinth Trollima often likes masquerading as hacktivist groups, and they adopted the identity The Guardians of Peace for this hack. They had spent at least 2 months hiding in Sony's network, collecting information on upcoming movies and personal information of Sony employees. They also leaked over 170,000 internal emails which made their way onto WikiLeaks. Nothing too interesting was in the emails, but the gossip column got a couple stories out of it. They ultimately didn't even prevent the release of the movie, but they did cause around $15 million in damages. All this over Seth Rogen. That was pretty bad if you were associated with Sony, but 2015 and 2016 saw hacks with much wider consequences for average people. In December 2015, the Russian APT Voodoo Bear, also known as Sandworm and APT-44, began a cyber attack against the energy grid of Ukraine. These attacks were against three power companies using a malware family called Dark Energy. The malware gave Voodoo Bear remote access to control systems for 30 power substations and allowed them to be remotely shut down. 250,000 people were left without power for up to 6 hours. Another attack came a year later in December 2016, this time centered around Ukraine's capital, Kiev. They again knocked out power for a few hours, but with a pretty evil twist. They tried to cause physical damage by disabling protections against power surges when the power would be restored. They also wiped the computers monitoring the power network so the operators couldn't know these safeguards were gone. For reasons that couldn't be shared for security reasons, this plan didn't work. Had it gone as planned, the whole substation could have exploded or suffered other severe damage. An attack that really disrupted life came a year later, with the attack of the WannaCry worm in May 2017. This was a ransomware program targeting Windows computers, using an exploit called Eternal Blue made by our friends at the NSA. It got leaked by a non-government hacking group and picked up by Labyrinth Trollima. It encrypted infected computers and demanded payment of $300 in Bitcoin, increased to $600 if the ransom wasn't paid within 3 days. It would delete the encrypted files entirely if payment wasn't sent within a week. The attack only lasted for 7 hours before a security researcher noticed a kill switch in the malware that could be activated in the form of a URL. It infected over 200,000 computers and netted the hackers 50 Bitcoin. North Korea has had difficulty moving this money, and it's believed the full amount hasn't made it to the country. Oh, and they never decrypted any computers. Didn't matter if you paid, your data was gone. There are decryptors available now for free, but they're hit or miss. Tons of organizations were affected by WannaCry, but maybe the worst hit was the National Health Service in Britain. Over 19,000 appointments were cancelled, and a third of hospitals were impacted. The NHS had been warned about cyberattacks in general a year prior, and received a warning from Microsoft about the Eternal Blue exploit specifically 2 months before. The NHS failed to act on both of these warnings. Eternal Blue wasn't just used with WannaCry, it got used again in the arguably worse NotPetya attacks of 2017. Petya, the original, was pretty boring, a fairly standard ransomware program spread by malicious emails in early 2016. Where it gets interesting is the NotPetya version used in 2017. This pretended to just be Petya, but it used Eternal Blue and a few other Windows exploits to spread itself without the user needing to do anything. It was deployed by our Russian friends Voodoo Bear, who distributed it via a popular tax filing service in Ukraine they hacked sometime before. NotPetya was way more destructive than Petya, and in fact it wasn't really ransomware, it destroyed many computers completely and used demanding a ransom as a cover story. Due to it spreading via Ukrainian software, Ukraine was the most affected. Many government offices and companies had to shut down for an extended time, and the incident is generally considered a deliberate attack against Ukraine by Russia. It did spread beyond Ukraine and affected some other countries and companies, most famously the shipping company Maersk. NotPetya caused an estimated $10 billion in damage, and is often considered the worst single cyber attack in history. One other attack afterwards disputes that title, the 2020 SolarWinds hack. It was actually a series of attacks against more companies than just SolarWinds, but that's the name that stuck. Around 2019, the Russian APTs Berserk Bear and Cozy Bear began exploiting vulnerabilities in Microsoft, VMware, and SolarWinds products to gain access to US government institutions. Using compromised Microsoft Office 365 accounts, the attackers were able to gain access to many confidential emails and documents inside the US government. They leveraged this access to infiltrate the network of SolarWinds and deployed malicious updates via the official update service to install remote access tools on over 18,000 computers. A huge list of government agencies were breached, as well as many private companies and local governments. This isn't even the full list, just the ones that came forward publicly. This incident was an example of a supply chain attack, one of the most potentially damaging types of cyber attacks. It's one of the most ambitious and one of the most useful, but it also takes a long time and a lot of skill to use. We've talked about some other attack vectors used by APTs, but let's talk about the preferred strategies of each country's APTs. Russia, as we've seen, has sabotage and destruction as a high priority goal. They've also previously been involved in harvesting credentials and data with no clear use for them. Compared to other countries, they focus more on government rather than a mix of private sector organizations like other APTs. They're quite technically advanced and prefer to use software flaws rather than social engineering as the backbone for their attacks. Russia is probably most similar to the United States in methodology. America also likes exploiting technical flaws and isn't interested in hacking corporations. The United States doesn't typically hack in a vacuum, so to speak. American cyber operations are almost always in support of a broader, more direct objective, like supporting CIA operations against Iran, as we've seen. The United States, revealed by leaked documents, conducts supply chain attacks in physical ways. Probably the most famous example was when Cisco routers had NSA surveillance equipment added into them in the Quantum Insert incident. The US, of course, also does software-based supply chain attacks, mostly taking advantage of the sheer amount of internet traffic that passes through America and allied countries. Through leaked documents, we know about the PRISM and X-Keyscore programs, which are essentially passive supply chain attacks gathering huge amounts of data from all around the world. China likely has a similar system, probably under their Golden Shield program. Otherwise, China loves a good phishing campaign. The software they use might not always be very sophisticated, but they're patient and willing to wait years inside a network. Intellectual property, designs, and patents are all high-priority targets for China, and they don't go after governments directly very often. China has been known to live off the land, using existing tools within organizations to spread and gather information while avoiding detection. While most APTs want to avoid detection, a few don't really care about being noisy. North Korea has been noticed as a de facto goal in many cases, since much of North Korean APT activity may as well be low-level terrorism. North Korea is, generally speaking, the only country that will hack for financial gain, as in the WannaCry case and the 2016 Bangladesh bank heist. North Korea focuses on the finance and media sectors, as well as the government of South Korea. Otherwise, there isn't a whole lot of rhyme or reason to their activities. North Korea only does acts of North Korea. Iran also likes to go after regional adversaries, particularly Saudi Arabia and Israel. Like North Korea, they focus on destruction in many cases and don't care that much about being caught. Probably their most famous attack was deploying the Shamoon wiper malware against Aramco in Saudi Arabia in 2012. Iran isn't super technically sophisticated, mostly relying on spear phishing for their attacks. More recently, the Iranian APT Charming Kitten has been trying to phish universities and media organizations. Let's wrap up with a few important things to keep in mind regarding the subject of nation-state hacking. Attributing any cyber attack or incident to a country is extremely difficult, and the link is always tenuous. In most cases, the evidence is completely circumstantial. The first step is to see who would actually benefit. If China is wanting to advance their aviation industry, for example, and suddenly a big aerospace company gets hacked, we have an idea who could be behind it. Or, if America makes Iran mad, and suddenly the biggest company in Iran's biggest rival country gets hacked, we can be fairly certain who did it. Of course, many countries have an interest in blaming a geopolitical adversary for anything bad that happens in their own country, as do corporations. No, we didn't lose your data because of our own negligence, it was North Korea, look at him, he did it. A method often paraded in the media is IP addresses. In the modern era, this is less than useless. Governments can fake IP addresses relatively easily or simply operate from proxies in other countries. APTs often deliberately use IPs in rival countries or just random other countries to increase their own plausible deniability. Other miscellaneous techniques, like seeing which language packs were installed on the computer that compiled malicious software or time zones on the computer, aren't reliable anymore. These were once methods that could be used to somewhat definitively identify a group, but have become pretty much just red herrings in recent years. It's become common for APTs to install random languages, usually Russian, Chinese, or Korean, to make it difficult to attribute it to anyone. The main methods for attributing an APT incident are things like spotting reused code or software, or seizing control servers used by the attackers. It's been possible, more commonly in the past than now, to even track down the real identities of those behind APTs, mainly by following trails of reused usernames and aliases. There's also other methods, mainly used by intelligence agencies, but they aren't talking. Overall, it's very difficult to blame any country for a hack. Just keep that in mind next time you hear about hackers from some faraway place on the news. It's a crazy time we're living in. Nation-state hackers and advanced persistent threats have changed how we all have to think about security in the modern age. Whether it's stealing classified information, sabotaging infrastructure, or simply sowing chaos, the impact of these attacks ripple far beyond their initial targets. For now, vigilance and adaptability remain the most critical defenses in navigating this unpredictable landscape.
Схоже, ввели недійсний номер, але нічого страшного. Просто перевірте його ще раз і перетелефонуйте.